Inside of me, a complete tranquility. I remember Allah, He remembers me. Feel the peace, feel the breeze. Fresh, pure, holy peace.
Born on 16th August 1998, Zafar Parkar is an intelligent child of class 6. He has received Certificate of Excellence in Science as well as in Maths. His hobbies include drawing and reading. He is very passionate about Dawah and thus he wants to be a Da'i, inshallah. Let's welcome Mr. Zafar Parkar speak on the topic Challenge of Islam.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولن ترضى عنك اليهود ولا النصارى حتى تتبع ملتهم قال رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي Respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters I welcome all of you With Islamic greetings, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. The subject of my talk is Challenge of Islam. Islam is a challenge to all the other isms, and more especially to the Jews and the Christians. There's a very close relationship between the teachings of Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad, peace be upon them all, or between Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And as soon as the Nabi Kareem, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, began to preach, especially in Medina, the Christians and the Jews strongly opposed his teachings, telling the Muslims that you follow this Ummi prophet, a person who does not know to read or write, he will only misguide you. You want to be right with God? You want Jannah? You want salvation? In that case, follow us. So Allah reminds us in the glorious Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 120. وَلَن تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَا النَّصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ O Muslims, the Jews and the Christians will never be satisfied with you unless you follow their brand of religion. And this statement of fact is evident. Wherever you go, the Jews have followed out a race in wanting to convert us. They have made their religion a racial religion. The only thing they want from us is to accept their rights to Palestine. You rob our brethren in the country of Palestine and give it to them and they will be satisfied with us. They do not convert anyone into their faith. Their faith is now a racial religion. You have to be born a Jew to be a Jew. They want political recognition, that's all. But the Christians are foremost in wanting to change our people, in converting our people to his way of life. And in that, there are more than 1,000 churches and denominations. Each and everyone is looking for converts. There are only two religions which are competing to capture the hearts and minds of people. Only two missionary religions, Christianity and Islam. These are the only two religions which are out to change people. So Islam claims to confirm, to correct, complete and supersede Christianity. It is the only religion which claims that. The Hindu would tell the Christian, look, you be a good Christian and I be a good Hindu. Leave me alone. The Buddhist would tell him, look, you be a good Christian and I be a good Buddhist. Leave me alone. Not so the Muslim. The Muslim is told to tell the Christian that God is one. He is not three in one. He is made to say, don't eat the pig, don't drink alcohol, don't gamble, don't be promiscuous. At every step, he is coming into confrontation with the Christian way of life. He is a challenge, and in the ocean of Christianity, we are a challenge. But now, he has developed new techniques. Firstly, they are into the media. They have their own satellite TV channels, their magazines, and much, much more, and on a very large scale. Previously, when the Christians had to preach as Muslims, they had to leave their homes, comfortable homes, and go to foreign lands, India, Africa, Malaysia, thousands of miles away from their homes. Now, they work from their own home base. They don't have to go thousands of miles away to go and preach. You are here, ready for them, ready customers. When we went to foreign lands, we adopted their culture. Culturally, we are ready to receive the message. Before, when these people came to foreign lands, they had to learn their native language. But now you have learned their language. That's English. He doesn't have to learn your language. Linguistically, you are ready to receive the message. And we Muslims are complacent. We pray 5 times a day, and so on and so forth. That's not enough, my brothers and sisters. We haven't fulfilled the purpose for what we are created. Is our purpose just to sit down, earn a good living, earn a good house, pray 5 times a day? Does it complete our duty as a Muslim? No. The duty of a Muslim is to share. Share this deen with the rest of mankind. It is a farz on the Muslim, along with his salah, zakah, and hajj, as it is a farz, similar is dawah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Al-Ghashiyah, chapter number 88, verse number 21 to 22, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرٍ. You deliver the message because it's your duty to deliver. You will not be questioned regarding them, why they accepted and why they did not accept it. The Muslims are not aware. You have started drinking alcohol and you have become one of them. And we are happy that we have become one of them. 3 points which they did not have before. They have it now and it's working. Moreover, 70,000 Christians are raising the dust all over the world and preaching Christianity. And the Muslim says, leave him alone. Why are you bothering him? Leave him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَنْ تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَا النَّصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. But become a Christian and he will be satisfied with you. They will never be satisfied with you unless you join them. Either you chain them or get chained. There is no other way. Where is the answer to all this? The answer is in the book of God, that is the glorious Quran. We have to acquaint ourselves with this book, which you are not doing. We only hear. We are prepared to die for this book, but we are not prepared to live for it. Because we don't know what it says. We may be praying 5 times a day, pictures of piety, but we know nothing about this book. So the Christians are taking advantage of that, and they're making inroads into our community. We must master the book, that is the glorious Quran. I quoted a verse in the glorious Quran. Where is it? I say, open the Quran and look in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 120. Allah is speaking to you directly. He's speaking to us direct. What do you want to know? You want to know about Jesus. Look into the index under J, just like a dictionary. Here you will read in Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, verse number 72, that Jesus, peace be upon him, denies divinity. لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمُ. They do blaspheme who say that Allah is Christ, the son of Mary. وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. But said Christ, O children of Israel, اُعْبُدُ اللَّهِ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ. Worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord. Innahu may yushrik billah, faqad harramahu Allah alayhi al-jannah wa ma'wahu an-nar. And whoever joins other gods with Allah, then Allah forbids him the garden, and the fire will be his abode. Wa ma liz-zalimin min ansar, and for the wrongdoers, there will be no one to help. You are being told to tell them about this, but we Muslims are just sitting back and doing nothing. My dear brothers and sisters, avail yourself a copy of this glorious Quran. Read it and implement it and arm yourself and go and preach them. This is the opportunity that Allah has given us. As much as they feel that they have an opportunity against you, you have the same opportunity against them. With these words, I would like to conclude my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran from Surah Al Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64. Qul ya ahl al kitab, say, O people of the book, ta'alaw ila kalimatin sawa'in bainana wa bainakum, come to common terms as between us and you. Allah na'budu illa Allah, that we worship none but Allah. وَلَا نُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا, and we associate no partners with him. وَلَا يَتَّخِذُنَا بَعْدُنَا بَعْدًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, and that we erect not from amongst ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَقُولُ اشْهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ, if then they turn back, then say, yea, bear witness that at least we are Muslims, bowing to Allah's will. وآخر دعوانا عن الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Jazakallah, Brother Zafar. Inshallah, with this reminder, we'll do a job of da'wah.
Fresh, pure, holy peace.
لبيك اللهم لبيك,
لبيك اللهم لبيك,
لبيك لا شريك لك,
لبيك لا شريك لك.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear Muslims who came from every corner in the world to the Holy Land in Mecca, this is Mamdouh Muhammad from the USA congratulating you for Hajj Mabrur.
Let's come under the shade of the scholars.
So the issue is a problem of knowledge.
Asim Al-Hakim.
Why do people do bidah?
Imam Malik said, whoever claims there is a good innovation in the deen.
Salim Al-Amri.
He is accusing that Prophet Muhammad did not convey the message.
Dr. Mamdouh Muhammad.
If you know that the Prophet ﷺ did something and I do something else, you have to follow the Prophet ﷺ, don't follow me.
Abdul Rahim McCarthy.
But if each one believes his goal is to please Allah, to follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah
ﷺ. Abdul Rahim Green.
I think this really is to do with your internal state.
Where does the Quran and Sunnah point to?
Muhammad Al-Sharif.
They have to follow what Allah and His Messenger said.
Let's imbibe from these scholars the fruitful solutions for the problems of the world.
Which one we would take and which one we would leave?
Question to every Muslim.
Question to every Muslim.
In the shade of the scholars. Tomorrow at 6 p.m. and repeat telecast at 5:30 a.m. India on Peace TV. A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. The last testament of God.
It is a proclamation to humanity, a fountain of mercy and wisdom, a guide to the erring, a warning to the heedless, an assurance to those in doubt, a solace to the suffering, a hope to those in despair. Al-Quran, the most positive book in the world, the final message of God to humanity. Let's read it, understand it, and follow it.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Fresh, pure, holy peace.
Madiha Qazi, a class 4 student, was born on 19th November 2000. Presently, she is 9 years and 6 months old. Her achievements include Certificate of Excellence in Makharij Tilawat al-Quran, Arabic language and English language. Madiha likes reading Islamic stories and singing Islamic songs. With good grasping power and leadership qualities, she is very enthusiastic on being a teacher and teaching the Islamic International School, inshallah. George Bernard Shaw said about our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and I quote, "He must be called the savior for the humanity. I believe that if a man like Muhammad were to assume the dictatorship of the modern world, would have succeeded in solving its problem in a way that would bring it much needed peace and happiness." Even the non-Muslims, historians, spoke so greatly about this hero of all times. We have Madiha Qazi speak on the topic, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, please welcome Sister Madiha Qazi.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Laqad kana lakum fi rasulillahi uswatun hasana. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. The topic of my talk is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you remember, few months or few years ago, a lot of talks were going around about Islam, and specifically the Prophet of Islam, where people were attributing all the atrocities which are taking place was the fault of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you remember, an evangelical priest in the USA by the name of Jerry Farrell, he spoke and he said, "I think that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a terrorist, and I think that Islam is a wicked religion. Na'udhu billah." On the other hand, when you compare fair-minded Westerners who did not necessarily revert to Islam, but they had studied about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be amazed by what these people had to say about him. Thus, we invite people to do study the life and seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. By the end of the day, you may not choose to follow his teachings and theology, but you will definitely not attribute such nonsense to this beloved man. When we look during the time when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, you will be amazed to see the similarities between what was going on back then and what is going on nowadays. You will feel that the world is in a need of a man like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let us analyze today the solution given in the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the problems that which the world is facing today. First, one thing that stands about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that he was one of the masses, and he spoke on behalf of masses. He was not an elite disconnected from the reality of his people. He was not an elite that was misled by majority living back then, but rather he was one of them, and he made sure that he speaks to them and he speaks on their behalf, and that is why people loved him more. Second, the other beautiful teachings that which we observe is that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam always preached for the basic needs of the humankind. And we see this in the teachings of the Quran, my dear brothers and sisters. In the fourth year of prophethood, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is receiving a revelation. And what is the revelation that he receives? Ara'aita allazi yukazzibu bid-deen. Have you seen the one who belies the religion? When you think a person belies the religion, What comes to mind? A person that does not pray, a person that does not believe in God, a person that does not believe in the Day of Judgment, a person that does not believe in the prophethood of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But the contrary of our expectation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this is the description of the one who belies the religion. What Allah says, Ara'aita allazi yukazzibu bid-deen. Have you seen the one who belies the religion? What are his characteristics? فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. And he does not encourage, and he does not promote the feeding of those who are poor. So, he's teaching us this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that from now onwards, if you want to see who truly believes or not, these are going to be your reference point. These are going to be your criterion that will tell us what kind of person you are. This shows the quality of working for the basic needs of the humankind. Third, subhanallah, of the characteristics of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will not expect a messenger, a prophet, to be a person that smiles or tells jokes or appreciates jokes. But if you look into the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be amazed by how approachable this man was and how much people loved him. They loved joking with him, and he also loved joking with them. We sometimes have erroneous belief that the more Muslim you are supposed to laugh less. Laughter is not unholy, brothers and sisters. In a hadith, a man asked the Prophet of Allah, what are the dearest deeds that Allah loves most? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, to bring joy into the heart of another believer. There are different methods to bring joy. Sometimes he speaks nice. Sometimes he may do something nice to them. And also sometimes he may tell them something funny. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you have the correct intention, then at that point you will be doing a deed that is most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said that there was a man. He was mashallah. He was a big man. Very, very big. A really big man. So he came to visit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he extended his head in the room. And he said, O Prophet of Allah, may I come in? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, come in and bring the rest with you as well. So here we see that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not only smiling, but also making the other people to smile as well. One problem, brothers and sisters, we have made with regards to our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that we only made imam out of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have limited Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the masjid. We have limited Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the pulpit. Do you give a khutbah in the same manner that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives the khutbah? Do you pray inside the masjid the same way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed? The minute you step outside of the masjid, you do not take the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with you, but rather you leave Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the masjid. And what happens at that point is that our imitation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam becomes very, very physical. It has to do with our appearance. Do we look like that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked? And please, do not misunderstand me. These things are very important. Whether you grow a beard, whether you want to wear the headgear that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did, you want to use miswak. These are the beautiful elements of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but by no means they reflect the moral character of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And for us to make a bigger deal of the appearance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but not of the character of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it is a catastrophe, and I think it is despicable. When people look like him, but they do not act like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then that becomes very, very problematic. Brothers and sisters, the figure of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the universal one. We must share the teachings of our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with everyone and follow him, not only by word, but even in spirit. I would like to conclude my talk with the verse from the glorious Quran, the same verse that which I quoted in the beginning of my talk from Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 21. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Verily, in the Messenger of Allah, you have the best exemplary character. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.
Jazakallah, Sister Madiha, for that heart-touching presentation. I quote in the words of Lamartine, a famous historian, philosopher, orator, apostle, legislator, warrior, conqueror of ideas, restorer of Russian dogmas, founder of 20 terrestrial empires, and one terrestrial empire, that is Muhammad. As regards all human greatness may be measured, one may as well ask, is there a man greater than he? In the words of Ramkrishna Rao, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a perfect model for the human life. May Allah help us to emulate him.
I feel the peace inside of me.